Ready to go?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Hi, everybody. Welcome to tonight's Selectmen meeting. It's October 24th. It's just about 6:30 PM. So let's please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all very much. Please have a seat. All right. So as we do when we start a meeting, we usually start with public announcements. I think everybody has one. Bob, would you want to start?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good evening, everyone. Just a reminder to support the Abington Public Schools, the white textile bins that are around the school buildings. It's the fall season. I just thought it's a good time to, if you're going through your summer stuff or your fall stuff or you're getting ready for the winter stuff, that we can recycle some things that help the schools. So if you know that there are over 520 million pounds of textiles that are dispersed in incinerators and landfills, 6% of America's trash is textile material. In Abington, that amounts to about 300 tons or $19,000 or close to $20,000. The Abington Public Schools have partnered with Bay State Textiles to bring textile recycling boxes to the school yards in town. The school's PTO generates revenue of about $100 per ton, as well as keeping trash fees down across the town. I just want to remind everyone some of the things you can put in these boxes. Bedding, comforters, sheets, pillows, blankets, belts, coats, ties, curtains, draperies, tablecloths, placements, stuffed animals. Oh, by the way, stuffed animals. I have about 3 billion stuffed animals in my home. Towels, bathrobes, hats, jackets, jerseys, gloves, scarves, purses, bags, totes, shoes, boots, flip-flops, and slippers. They can recycle shoes, boots, flip-flops, and stickers. That's a big thing. That's weight. That's good stuff. Skirts, dresses, t-shirts, jeans, pants, shorts, pajamas, socks, undergarments, sweatpants, sweatshirts, vests, shirts, sweaters, blazers, and slacks. Anything that's torn, ripped. But it's good to utilize to help the town and help the school system. So just a reminder that we should be doing that. If you have any questions, please contact the Board of Health. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bob. So, but it might be easier to say what we can't recycle. Mm.
Well, it's good to get stuff in the box, so.
I'm just kidding. Thank you very much. Thank you. Alex?
Yes, this Sunday, October 30th, behind the Beaverbrook Elementary School, will be the Cardamon Family Softball Tournament and Fun Day Fundraiser. This event is to raise money for the Cardamon family to help them offset the medical expenses and traveling back and forth to Boston. And it was actually organized by most of the firefighters we have here tonight. The opening ceremonies begin about 8:30. The games begin at 9. There's lots and lots and lots of kids' activities, so it's definitely a family-friendly event. There'll be lots of raffles and all kinds of stuff for kids, food, DJ all day. So please come out and support an Abington family. Sunday at 8:30 behind Beaverbrook Elementary School, and it'll go all day.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks, Alex. Andy?
Yes. Early voting for the November 8th general election is now available at the town hall. At the town clerk's office, you can vote early from October 24th to November 4th. The extended hours are Monday through Thursday from 8:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., Friday from 8:30 a.m. until 12:30 p.m., and then even on this Saturday, October 29th, you can vote from 9 until 1 at the town office building. And the other thing I have is the Abington Community Craft Fair is this Saturday, October 29th, from 10 to 3 at the Abington Senior Center. That's an annual event that the Friends of Abington Seniors put on and helps them raise money for senior activities.
Do we know what time?
10 to 3.
10 to 3. Thank you. Great. Thank you, Andy. Ken?
Speaking about voting, there was something left for all of us. November 3rd is Election Day at the Abington Public Library. This year's hotly contested election between two popular children's book characters, Fly Guy and Pete the Cat. We respectably suggest you research their individual platforms and then come to the library, cast your vote. Vote early, vote often. The voting booth will be open 10 to 8:30 on Thursday, November 3rd. And another long tradition here in Abington, The annual Turkey Supper at the United Church of Christ is going to be held on November 5th from 5 to 6:30. Turkey meals, cafeteria style, very low cost, $12 for adults, and a cap of $36 for all families. Limited number of tickets will be available. Call a church, 781-878-0199.
Great, thank you. That's it? I have one other announcement. The Abington Police Department, as they do at this time, as we get close to Halloween, have asked us to make a bit of an announcement. So with regard to the upcoming Halloween holiday, in order to promote a safe and enjoyable event, the Abington Police Department has announced that the hours for trick-or-treating in the town of Abington on Halloween are from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. The Abington Police Department encourages residents to shut off their outside lights after 8 p.m. to reinforce the hours that were established with safety in mind. Parents should also make sure their children are aware of the, quote, candy deadline in advance. All parents should have a discussion with their children about respecting other people's property and, most importantly, adhering to the following safety tips. Adults should accompany young children. Older children should trick-or-treat in groups of at least three or more. Parents should clearly know the trick-or-treat route that their children will be taking. Children should only trick-or-treat in familiar and well-lit neighborhoods. Children should wear costumes that are light-colored and garbed with reflectors. Children should not wear masks or use makeup that interferes with proper vision or hearing. Children should carry flashlights with new batteries or glow sticks. Children should not carry hard plastic or wooden props, such as daggers or swords. Substitute with foam rubber, which is soft and flexible. Adults and children should watch for traffic at all times, even on side streets. Remember that Halloween is on a Monday night this year. Motorists should drive well below the speed limit for up to an hour before and after the posted trick-or-treat hours. Trick-or-treaters should go to all the houses on one side of a street before they cross over to the other side and not zigzag back and forth for safety purposes. Trick-or-treaters should stay on sidewalks, driveways, and walkways to avoid ruts or holes in lawns. Trick-or-treaters should not accept unwrapped or unpackaged candy, and parents should, of course, inspect the candy before anything is eaten. If you have any questions, by all means, you can contact the Abington Police Department. Also, with regard to store owners, the Abington Police Department has requested that Abington store owners not sell any of the following products to children under the age of 18 from October 28th to November 1st, and that includes spray paint, eggs, soap, shaving cream, and toilet paper. And parents, of course, are requested to notify the Abington Police Department if they observe any local stores violating this request. Abington Police will also be adding additional marked and unmarked and bicycle patrols during this holiday to make sure it's safe for all who participate. And again, you can visit the Abington Police Department website, www.abingtonpolice.org, for any additional safety tips.
Probably no clown costumes either this year.
That would probably be a bad choice this year. That would draw attention to yourself. All right, well, great. So that, having the public announcements be written, next thing is we are very fortunate tonight to have some of our Abington finest, the fire chief is here, and a number of the fire department are here. We have a badge pinning ceremony. Chief, welcome. Welcome to all the firefighters and paramedics.
Thank you. We're taking over one of your meetings again, but it's always a good thing, I think, when we do this. First of all, Selectman Bazanton, I'd like to thank you for mentioning the softball tournament that the Abington Firefighters Local 208 really have organized. In conjunction with that, they've agreed that they're helping out the Signature Healthcare through Dr. Muse. He's our medical director, as well as the Plymouth County DA's office and the Brockton Opioid Coalition. They're going to be doing some demonstrations throughout that event of how to do CPR, administer Narcan, how to recognize some of the signs and symptoms of sports-related injuries, for example, concussions. And the whole coalition has printed up about 500 pamphlets that include a lot of this information that the residents can take home with them. So I just want to give them a plug. I'm very proud of them for doing that and agreeing to also help out the community with that as well. Tonight, we're able to show you and share with you the full spectrum, hopefully, of what a long career in the fire service can be, from the beginning as well as what we're going to see toward the end, that really, once you're a firefighter, you're always a firefighter. And we want to recognize somebody that has done that with helping out the residents. First, Mike, you want to come up? stand right there. The first order of business is I want to introduce to the town of Abington our newest firefighter paramedic. This is Mike Mastuccio. Mike is from originally from the Hamilton Fire Department. Now, I had to look to see where Hamilton, Mass. Was. It's up by Rockport, basically next to Beverly. And he was a member of the Hamilton Fire Department up there for a short time. He also served as an emergency paramedic from the Rockport to Boston area. So I've had a lot of people ask, where are we getting these guys from and girls from? You know, they're not necessarily, as much as we'd love to get the residents, and we have some Abington residents we were able to get. It's all through civil service. We're very fortunate with civil service. They've helped the Abington Fire Department interview, hire, train, and retain a lot of employees. Mike is just our latest example of this. We've had firefighters from Lakeville, Halifax, Boston EMS. The entire room is full of the products of what we were able to accomplish and retain. So we're very fortunate for that, first of all. So that's where we got Mike from. Hamilton, again, I had to look at the map. I had no clue. Mike chose Abington. We're very proud of that. We thank you for choosing Abington. Mike graduated from the Mass Fire Academy on October 3rd. He was already a paramedic. Again, we're able to vet seasoned paramedics, experienced paramedics, before they go to the Mass Fire Academy. At that point, even if they have some firefighter experience, we still make them go to one of the fire academies, usually the Mass Academy in Stowe. We've also sent some to the Brockton Fire Academy and a couple to the Boston Fire Academy. It makes for a very diverse and dynamic fire department. Mike just completed his two-week orientation with our department in Abington, specifically on how we operate, how our equipment operates, where our sprinkler systems in the buildings are, where the fire control systems are, specific things to Abington. It's important that all of these members really know where it is. That's a lot of experience. It takes time to learn that, learning the streets of Abington. There's a lot of streets in Abington that residents have grown up here their whole lives. They probably have no idea where that street is. And GPS is great, but when somebody's asking you directions, you're going to know where it is. He's working on that. He'll be there soon, just as everybody else has. So Mike began working his first shift just a week ago. So at this point, I'm very proud to announce that the Abington Fire Department is at full staff, first time in many years. We have no openings, and it works. The six-man shifts are definitely working. We're running two ambulances to help pay for it. The grant will end shortly, but I'm comfortable and confident that the additional revenue from operating the second ambulance is working. And this gives us a great foundation to begin when Southfield, or the former Naval, South Weymouth Naval Air Base, really begins to build up. Because we know, I think, what that's going to do to our call volume, not only my department, but the other departments in town as well. So we're in a great position right now. I'm proud of that. We certainly, in the last 5 years, we have rebuilt the fire department. We have retooled the fire department, both with purchases of the tower truck, as well as many grants we're able to do. We have incredible equipment right now. We're in very good shape. And we have re-energized the fire department. Look at the room. We're doing great. Couldn't be prouder. So with that, I'd like to invite Mike's dad up, who's going to have the honors of officially pinning him with his badge, his firefighter's badge. There you go, sir. You can stab him. We got plenty of paramedics in the room.
Congratulations, kid.
Welcome to Abington. Now, the second reason we're here tonight, and it just happened to be the timing couldn't have worked out better to have all of this in the same night. Chief, want to come up? I'd like to introduce retired Rockland Fire Chief Mike Salmon, who was actually somewhat reluctant to be here. He's very shy. Seriously, he's just doing his job, and he will tell you that. However, I want the town to know what job he did, and he really needs to be recognized, which we are. This, again, goes into the fact, once a firefighter, always a firefighter. Once you get firefighting in your blood, it certainly is in your blood. His brother is here, who's a current lieutenant on Rockland Fire Department. He's not allowed to speak. at all. Sons are on different fire departments in the area, trying to get on fire departments. So he's, and he's retired. You've been retired, I think, 6 years, Chief?
Eight.
8 years. He's been retired longer than half my department's been employed. On the night of October 14th, it was just a week ago Friday, about 10 o'clock at night, retired Chief Salmon and his family were driving through Abington on Plymouth Street on Route 58, and he noticed what appeared to be a fire under the porch of a porch attached to a home on Plymouth Street. Being a seasoned firefighter, he knows exactly what he's looking at. He stopped, he recognized it, he get out, indeed it was a fire. The residents did not know that the fire had been burning. He called 911, he alerted the residents, he got them out. They were, you know, rather young people from, you know, 17 to 20 years old at the time. And then he began to fight the fire. He found a garden hose around the back, this is in the dark, and he began to put the fire out, and he did put the fire out. By the time our crews arrived, we still had some fire that was going, and upon the complete overhaul of the porch, which means we sometimes cause damage to make sure the fire is out. The fire can be like a cancer in the building, we have to make sure it's out. The amount of char that had been in there, even though it was a small fire in the early stages, there was enough heat that undoubtedly, had this gone on longer without being recognized, this would have engulfed the home. There's no question in my mind. He saved that home that night. Our crews can attest to that. I was there myself. I saw how much fire damage was there. The damage to the home is minimal. It's repairable. In fact, I think it already has been repaired from what I saw. The family was here earlier tonight. They were able to thank Chief Salmon before they had to leave. They did get a chance to see him. But we just wanted to thank you, number one, for doing that. I was going to get you a gift certificate to either the Purple Eggplant or Vinny's.
I'm all set. I'm all set. Doing fine.
Your brother will explain that to you. But instead, we just want to present you with this citation for thanking you. And it just says, Abington Fire Department Certificate of Merit presented to Chief Michael Salmon, retired, for actions taken to during a house fire on October 14, 2016.
Thank you,
Thank
Chief.
You very much. Give a fire chief a mic.
Thank you very much. As I look around the room, I know if in the situation, whether it be any one of these guys, whether it be fire, police, I guarantee you they would have done the same thing. It was just timing, and I'm just glad it all worked out. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Just in closing, my last remarks is I just want to, between the examples we've seen tonight, between firefighter paramedic Mastuccio and all of the work that he recently did getting through the academy, getting him to the point to be employed by us, previous to even being interviewed, he became a paramedic. He was experienced as a paramedic. It's all part of the journey. To the very end, to even retired firefighters, they're still active. They're still working, still protecting the residents of the town of Abington. And I want to thank the entire room. They're all here. They all came in their own to welcome everybody here, to thank Chief Salmon for what he did, and I couldn't be prouder of all of you. Thank you very much.
You guys. We're going to take a second so that we can say hello and congratulate. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. We're all back, so we can, I'll sign this and we can move along. All right, ready back? All right, we're back. Okay, thank you. Well, that's, it's always nice to have a celebration like that in one of our meetings. Sometimes our meetings are either dry, they help put you to sleep, but this is a good one tonight. All right, so moving along, next on our agenda is, we among the board have talked about wanting to have department heads come in, and since John Stone is here, I'm going off a little bit off the agenda a little bit, but since you're here, do we want to do that right now? Or
yeah,
we could do an appointment.
He is up, that is him, he is up.
Yes, I know he's here.
Sorry.
No, I'm saying, I think there's also an appointment here that we could do too. Appointment of Conservation Commission?
I don't think they have.
She's not here, so, all right, so John.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, yeah.
I didn't want to make anybody wait if we were just going to do an appointment,
okay.
Yeah, please come on up, John, thank you.
Yes.
Our official new DPW.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you for the opportunity, everybody.
Uh-huh.
I'll try to do a good job, make everybody proud.
Right. And just as a quick preface, I know in one of the agenda items that some members of the board would like to see on an ongoing basis, some occasional updates from our multiple department heads. And I thought, just to really throw Mr. Stone to the wolves as a kind of the department head of our new Public Works Department, I thought we'd give him a chance to show his stuff, and I assured him this was a real easygoing crowd tonight, so.
Everyone left.
So, that's right. So,
yeah, but we asked a ton of questions.
That's right. So, so John, it's all you.
All right. Did everyone get the handout in
yes.
the packet?
Yes. Yeah.
The first attachment is ever since the accident back in March, we've received tens and tens of calls about dead trees on the side of the road, and first attachment is a list of the trees we've taken down. So far we've taken down 79 trees, and we've done it on a priority basis. The ones that look to be the most dangerous, we've taken them down first. So we stand at 79 trees total, and we still have a few more to go, and I'm sure the calls have become more sporadic, and we're out checking and looking to see if there are trees we think are dangerous, and we add them to the list. But the list is dwindling, and but these are the trees we've taken down so far.
John, with the weather conditions being so dry throughout the whole summer years, trees that don't look to be damaged, it could be damaging this year, especially if you have rain and ice and stuff like that. So there could be, I mean, this is in the statewide, not just for you, but
absolutely.
Statewide, it's been mentioned that could be potentially a very hazardous winter with trees that have been dried out and then get iced up and will collapse sooner, even if the tree looks really good.
Absolutely. I've been talking to our tree guy, and he said something very similar. We're in the middle of a three-year drought, not good for the trees. You know, one might not even look dead and still could be a hazard, but we're doing the best we can.
Okay.
We're doing our due diligence.
Thank you.
Real quick, John, is that something that one of our town employees does, or do we contract that out?
We contract these out. Most of these are well over 30. If they're under 30 feet high, we usually can take care of it ourselves, because our bucket truck only goes 35 feet high.
Yeah.
And most of these were in the vicinity of 40 to over 100 feet high.
Thank you for doing that.
It's just cheaper for a contractor to come in and just go.
Right.
Yeah.
But we definitely, we take care of some of the smaller ones, some of the pruning, things of that nature.
And I would just also point out that obviously they are really dependent upon the eyes of the community, because I haven't counted, but there are obviously, I'm sure, tens of thousands of trees lining the roadways of Abington. So in order to really try and deal with them on a priority basis, there's no way that the limited staff of the Public Works Department can adequately assess those. But they do their best, as they say, you know, in terms of if they can determine by sight as they're out and about doing their regular business. But there's really no practical way to assess, obviously, all the trees on public property. So
that's a good public service announcement.
Yes.
Any more about trees?
So if anybody does have any trees that they think are compromised, they can call
absolutely
your office or send you an email.
Yep. 781-982-2122.
Mm-hmm.
But those,
or email.
Those are trees on town-owned property.
Correct.
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 Yes.
In your yard.
Yeah, if it's in your yard,
you're
on your own.
Yeah, and suffice to say that there've been plenty of those calls too, where people did believe that.
Well, can you come look? Come on, just take a look.
But I give people credit; it doesn't hurt to try. But it's that's, the town does not take down trees on private property, though. No, right. So, that's the other public service public safety announcement. So I'm sorry. Yeah.
Any more on trees?
No, we're good.
All right, the next attachment is Rick asked us to come up with a road rating system to rate the roads in town.
Yeah.
So that's your next attachment. We rated every road.
All the roads in town?
Yes.
Yeah.
Scale of 1 to 5, 5 being best.
Mm-hmm.
It's a starting point anyway.
Right. So you can set your priorities. Is this for... like you said, paving,
exactly.
Sidewalks, and
exactly.
All that.
Right. And this was
mostly paving.
And this was advised by the state.
Yes.
DOT had advised them. This is kind of a similar ranking system that they use. So this wasn't just something that was concocted locally. This is similar to what the state uses. So, sorry, John. Go ahead.
That's all right. There's just one typo on here. Colburn Lane. For some reason didn't come out on the spreadsheet, but that's a newer road. That's probably 8 years old.
I didn't catch that, John.
Probably
I'm
give
sorry.
It a 4
that's,
or 5, I would say. But anyway, this gives us a starting point.
Do you have given this as a starting point, do you have an agenda or a list of attributes you're going to utilize to decide when and if and how things are going to move forward as far as this? Looking at street repaving and stuff like that?
We'll use this list. You know, any ones on here would be a priority. I know the Green Street area, a lot of ones. Hershey Lane area, a lot of ones. But with our limited Chapter 90 funds, we can't do like the whole Hershey neighborhood.
Right.
But you can just patch or you can just do small.
Well, I mean, we patch it all the time, but it would need a lot more money to do the whole Hershey Lane.
Rick, write him a check, Rick.
right.
Plus, the streets are very wide up there in that area, too. So it's, I think they're 30 feet wide.
Okay.
It would be a huge capital investment. Okay. But we're going to work on it, you know. Maybe we could do it street by street as time goes on.
Mm-hmm. I think the other thing, too, is it certainly gives a plausible, it's a rationale for how you do spend your Chapter 90 funds, and
yes.
And obviously this is something that is a work in progress, and this is a draft. I'm not questioning the, you know, how well it's been performed, but this is I think, not that I have expertise with roadways, but this is other than me and Dory, the board members are the first ones that have seen this, other than outside the Public Works Department. So if you have questions or about any of what you see here, feel free to discuss, put those forward. But obviously, you know, there shouldn't be any question about how the town chooses to spend its Chapter 90 funds. It should be based upon some, you know, rationale, and hopefully this, you know, over time will be the basis for that. It shouldn't be based upon, you know, if, you know, it happens to be the street that John lives on. Well, John lives in East Bridgewater, so that's not an issue, but we don't need those kinds of questions, obviously.
Definitely not.
There should be a rationale for it, and so this would be a rationale. So, and if there's any, obviously, if there's any particular areas that would seem to require attention that would be outside of our Chapter 90 allowance, that perhaps we would need even a capital expenditure if it was that dire, then again there would be some rationale for that too. So
what's the normal time of year? I know you do get a lot of this in the spring, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Springtime.
Not to do a lot of fall.
No.
Well, the spring after the winters have beat up the streets a little bit.
Definitely.
Uh-huh.
In the summer too.
Yeah.
That's when we try to get the paving done.
If you do a repaving of a street, do you do that yourself, or is that outside contractors?
That's outside contractors.
And John, there are some town roads as well. Like 18 is a town road, right?
State road, yes.
State road, yeah. State road is 139 also.
No, that's ours. Most of 123 is a state-owned road as well. A little small portion of it is ours.
18 and 123 of the state.
Correct.
So just looking at the list, John, it looks like For 2016, you did two streets, Clap Street and Vernon Street, were those the...
Correct. In progress.
Oh, you did Progress Street as well?
Yes.
What, if you know, I don't know if you know, what did those cost for those three streets, do you know?
And we did Ashland, Andy, I'm sorry. We did Ashland, too, yes.
You did all of Ashland Street?
Ashland was bad. That, it come out really nice.
Yeah, that was okay.
It depends on the length. I think Progress cost us about $80,000. And Ashland, more, probably in the vicinity, $140,000.
Long Street, yeah.
Long Street, long road. And we started the Green Street area with Clap, and I'd like to continue in the Green Street area.
Yeah, I see the, a lot of the Green Street streets are ones.
They weren't, they haven't been paved since the sewer went down the roads in the 80s. That's when most of the streets in town were last paved, when the sewer went down.
Right.
John, some of these streets where the water department's now installing new water...
Yes.
Summit, Temple.
They're gonna...
Are they responsible to...
Totally.
That's part of their...
They're gonna pave it, sidewalk, curb to curb, total repaving.
And they'll do that in the spring, probably.
Yeah, I think they're gonna wait a year for the trenches to settle, then they go to curb, complete overlay, and that's part of the project.
Temple Street, Summit.
Yep, Temple, Summit, Oakland Circle, and Greenwood.
Good.
So then you can move those up to number fives, right?
We can give them fives. I like giving them fives, I don't like seeing a bunch of ones.
Especially fives if we don't have to pay for it.
Especially fives if we don't have to pay for it, definitely.
Well, we are paying for it.
We like water mains.
True. We always pay for it. Good. Any other questions about the roads?
No, I think this is very good. I think this is something we should maintain on a yearly basis.
Absolutely, we plan on doing it.
Right, and again, I know you haven't had much time to look at it, but if you do have further questions, feel free to...
Absolutely.
Pass them along to me and John, and we'll, you know, try to provide some rational explanations, so... I'm sorry.
You're in.
All right, a lot of questions, we've had a lot of questions about the status of the Nipperty's permit. Unfortunately, I have no more news at this point.
No.
No.
Yeah.
Might want to explain what that is.
Yeah, I was gonna say, you might want to explain that to the world.
The people at home may not know what that means.
That's the, the town of Abington obviously doesn't own their own wastewater treatment plant, so we discharge to the city of Brockton's wastewater treatment plant, and we worked out a deal in our intermunicipal agreement where we're gonna get an extra 500,000 gallons a day, but that is contingent on the signing of the new discharge permit, which they call the Nipperty's permit. We've been waiting about 14 months now, and...
And there was a story in the paper yesterday? Yesterday, I think, on that.
Oh, someone called me, yeah. Someone called me on my cell phone.
So,
Probably.
That was you? Yeah.
See, I told you.
I was raking leaves in my yard.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, so I did send that along to Congressman Lynch today, and he suggested that we do try and meet with the Lieutenant Governor. If you could do that, and Bill Carpenter. I mean, Mayor Carpenter is definitely behind this and wants to...
Absolutely, the city of Brockton is definitely behind it.
So I think it's time that, you know, we've waited long enough. It's time to get the governor and the lieutenant governor involved in it and see if someone can put some pressure on EPA to get this moving.
Absolutely. Yes, sir.
If we get the 500,000 gallons of additional, how is that managed out? How do we make decisions on how that 500,000 gallons is going to be utilized?
How do we make decisions on it? First of all, I don't think we'll ever use the whole 500,000 gallons.
It's you'll never reach there.
Well, I raised this because of a question I asked earlier a couple of weeks ago. It's like, for me, I live on Orange Street and on 18. I'm watching single-family homes get developed into multiplex homes, and I don't know if they're getting sewer or not, if they're on Title V connections and stuff like that. But my question really relates to is, like, as we see more of these developments happen in the town, and we can't stop development, I understand that, but when you see a single-family home that had one septic field or one septic sewer, and now you see there's 6, 7, or 8, or 10 or more in there, you kind of ask the question, are we chewing up all of our soon-to-be gut sewer usage, hookup, stuff like that? So.
Right. I know a lot of what you see in town right now is Title V.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's a property at the corner of Route 18 and Summit Road. I think a 10-unit apartment building. I've received a lot of calls on it. That's Title V.
Yep.
I don't know which particular...
That's the one I got a lot of calls on, too.
That's the one you got, that is...
I got three people pulling on my driveway asking me the same question.
Yes, we got a lot of calls on that. He's going Title V there because he only has an allotment of 250 gallons per day. He's going to need a lot more than that for 10 units, so he's going Title V.
I guess that would not prohibit him from, once we get the 500,000 gallons, tying into the system at that point in time, right?
As long as he pays his betterment, his systems development fees and things of that nature, yes, he could do that.
Yeah, and there's other developments in town like that, too.
Yeah.
But if, think of it this way, Bob, the whole town right now is, what, 1 million gallons? Is that what we...
We're allotted 1 million gallons per day.
So this whole town right now is 1 million gallons, and we're going to get half of that again. So it would be...
We don't have the
capacity to build that much.
If you look back into the mid-'80s, when all the development started up off of Hancock Street and all those developments and everything, and everything that's been built between, like, 1985 and now, mm-hmm. that we had 500,000 back then, and they boosted it to 1 million mm-hmm. back around that time. So we don't have the land or the room to build what we've built in town since 1985. So I agree with you. I don't think we're ever going to exceed the 1.5.
I don't think so.
But what it will do is a lot of these vacant business locations and other developments will be able to bring those in, get those going, and start getting some tax revenue out of these things. And that's what's hurting us now. We can't expand because we don't have the sewer. And there's a huge tax base out there of projects that have been approved that we're not collecting the taxes on right now.
Correct. We have one subdivision in particular. They're waiting for the sewer, and they don't perk. They don't have the option of Title V, so they're just at a standstill.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You missed one. Just quickly on our. I know it's not a.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Major problem.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, no problem.
Heavy vehicle exclusions. I talked to the old Colony Planning Council, and they're going to perform some traffic counts for us on the streets of West Chapel Street, Orange Street, Belmont Street, and Chapel Street, and Bank Street, to see if they meet the criteria of heavy vehicle exclusions. And that'll be at no cost to the town. But one of the criteria is 5% of the total traffic volume on those streets have to be heavy vehicles. So if we meet that criteria, we might be able to move forward with heavy vehicle exclusion.
How long does that process take, John?
He said he will do the traffic counts by the end of the fall.
Thanks.
I met with him last Thursday.
Does this include the one that there was one right up kind of off of Washington that goes into Rockland?
That's a different exclusion.
Okay, that's a different exclusion.
Yes.
Right. And that's been applied for. There were traffic counts done for that, and they have applied. Whitman has applied for that. And
we just agreed.
Yes, you...
Washington Street.
We sent a letter of support for that, correct, yes.
And that's along the same lines, but just different streets.
Correct.
All right, any other questions about that? So end of fall. Keep going, you're doing great.
All right, I don't know if you know or not, but we combined the clerical office into one office consisting of highway, sewer, and parks and recreation.
Is that at the highway department?
That's at 350 Summer Street. That's where we have the clerical office. DPW administration offices now. 350 Summer Street. We felt it was a better building.
How many folks do you have in the office right now?
Let's see, we have 4.5, 3.5, 3 full-timers and a part-timer. Mm-hmm. We just had one retire, and we're not going to fill that spot. So that's going to save us probably $35,000 a year.
But that was a full-timer?
That was a full-timer.
Nice. So you're finding sort of scale and efficiencies being closer together?
Definitely.
That's what we had hoped, I think.
It's working out good.
Great.
And how many employees outside of the administrative staff do you have, John? Just the regular?
7 at the highway, and 5 at the sewer. So 12 total.
So are they kind of doing cross?
Not yet, Andy. There's a lot of collective bargaining issues that go along with that. I thought it would be smoother, but it hasn't been smooth as of yet.
Okay.
The clerical side was very smooth. This is going to take some time.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's the goal, right?
Yes, that is the goal. They're in the process of agreeing to updated position descriptions. Now, that's not to say that there aren't, there is some overlap. I mean, there are some, I'd say, urgent activities that there's some overlap at times. That's not a question. But on a routine daily basis, those types of activities are still subject to updated position descriptions.
Okay.
So, that fair to say?
That's fair to say. We're trying, you know.
Yeah.
We had a training on the new artificial turf fields at the high school, and we brought everybody up there, just so everyone knows.
Yep.
You know, things like that. We're training people in different areas, but as day-to-day operations, not really yet. We haven't gone that far yet. Hopefully soon, or someday anyway. And we plan on, if any questions on that?
I noticed you didn't mention anything with Park and Rec as far as employees are concerned. You only mentioned sewer and highway.
Oh, no, we have Park and Rec down there, too.
Okay.
Yeah, everyone's in one building.
Okay. Thank you.
We plan on shutting down, winterizing all the buildings at the Island Grove coming up soon. This year, we had a lot of broken pipes, broken plumbing fixtures because they weren't winterized properly. So we're going to do it right this year. That way, we don't have to spend any money doing that. So I just wanted to update you guys that we'll be shutting down those buildings pretty soon.
Can I ask a question on that?
Sure.
You're probably going to get asked it soon. We might be asked it. But the new the Girl Scout cabin in the woods, they call it now.
Yes.
Now, is that going to come under the control of the Parks and Rec as far as renting it out, that sort of stuff, for how that's going to work? Or you want to have a subcommittee or something?
I'm not sure, Ken. Okay. All I know is it looks great. It looks fantastic.
Really nice, yes.
Right now, it's scheduled through your office,
right,
for meetings. I mean, I don't know. That's who people would contact right now.
Okay. My reason is it's probably going to be in demand.
Okay.
You know, because it's really nice and it can suit a lot of different purposes.
Yeah,
and even maybe functions, you know, because it's
yeah,
so nice. It has a nice rustic, you know, feel to it. So I'm just, my concern is that I want to make sure that anybody that wants to use it, and they follow the proper procedure, that they're able to get it. That's all. I just, you know, I didn't know if
you could call us.
Okay.
Our office, our main office.
Okay.
We're in the process of updating our website anyway, and I have all of our numbers and emails in a better format.
Perfect.
It's going to take us a little time, but we're working on that right now.
Okay.
And that's pretty much all I have, other than the new high school is going to, it includes two new pump stations that we're going to be responsible for, bringing our townwide total to 14 pump stations that run 24 hours a day. So it'll be more work for us.
Yep.
It's all right.
Keeps you busy.
Keeps us busy.
John, before you go, can you give us an update on snow and ice as we move into that? Like, usually they're like purchasing salt or sand.
Yeah, the salt sheds are full. One of them's full, excuse me. One of them's full. But we'll make sure that they're both full, ready to go.
How are you doing on subcontractors?
Doing good.
All set?
Yep.
Equipment is good to go?
Equipment's good to go.
I'm not rushing it.
No, it's good to go.
Good.
And I just want to personally thank you on behalf of the board, probably everyone in town too. I mean, you've been doing an outstanding job just starting.
Thank you very much.
I mean,
challenge.
It's refreshing to, when anybody calls you, and I mean anybody, you don't say no. You just say, I'll make it happen. So that's really good. So thank you.
And on that note, if I may,
what do you need?
I got a phone call a couple of months ago about a sidewalk collapsing near my house, and I called John in the morning, and by the time I went home that night, they had already been out there to fix it. They paved it the next day. There was an issue about paint in the ladies' room, I guess, at Island Grove.
Yes.
During must have been Flag Day weekend. That Monday they were in there painting it. So anything that we've asked for, it's been taken care of right away, and we appreciate that.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity.
Because we get the calls. and we'd have to call you.
Feel free to call anytime.
I would echo that, too. I also, maybe a couple months ago, got something about a crosswalk. Someone wanted a crosswalk either...
Kimber Circle.
Kimber Circle. They moved a little bit, repainted, and you guys were incredibly responsive. So thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So now that you got all those accolades, John, I'm going to ask you.
Yeah. That's right.
What do you think would be your top priority that you need at your department at this point?
Top priority? Probably the bringing the union together, union negotiations, the collective bargaining, as Rick alluded to. Get them on the same page. That's going to be a challenge because we've been separate departments for so long, and it's nobody's fault. It's just change is difficult.
Yeah.
It's nobody's fault. It's just difficult.
How are you doing equipment-wise?
Fine.
Yeah.
We're doing good.
When's the last time we purchased any?
On the sewer side of things, we purchased a couple of vehicles recently. Down the highway, we really haven't purchased anything in a while. I know in the past they've used Chapter 90.
Yes.
But I think it's right now it's more important to take care of some of these ones. But eventually we might have to go the route of Chapter 90 to buy equipment.
But right now the equipment you think is
in
decent shape?
I think it's in decent shape. I think a street sweeper might be in order in a couple of years, maybe three years. They're talking to Jack about it.
Okay.
He thinks about 3 years, street sweeper, 130,000. By then, it might be 140,000.
Okay, great. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you, Gene.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you. So that was nice to have that update. I think it's a really good idea. I think, Andy, I know you mentioned that, to like have department heads in periodically to give us a straight up what's going on. And I like your question about asking them about their priorities as well. Okay, so let's get into doing some housekeeping things here. Approval of September 12th open session minutes, also October 3rd open session, October 3rd executive session. So who was here? If we're all here for September 12th.
Move we approve those.
Motion. Second.
Could I just make one comment and hopefully we could add? On page 2, request for a Class 2 license, DBA O'Malley's Auto Sales. I believe that Mr. Burbine asked the owner if there were going to be any employees, and he stated that he was going to be the only employee there at all times. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to have that added to the minutes if I could.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Other than that, I have no problem with the minutes.
So, make that motion without amendment then. Feel free.
Okay. So all those in favor of the motion amended?
Yeah. Aye.
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 All right. So that's great. Approve that. The next one would be the October 3rd minutes. October 3rd, looks like we were all here that day, too. So accept a motion to approve the minutes of October 3rd, open session.
So moved.
Second.
All of those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you, guys. And then the last one would be the October 3rd executive session minutes. We were all there for that also. What would that? Let's see.
Will they be approved and not released until all matters are resolved?
Second.
All right, and all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you, guys. Get some housekeeping out of the way. Now, we have one appointment to the Conservation Commission, an alternate member, Mary Ellen Basham. I don't think we have her here, but so Jory, we've done that. Is this the only open member seat?
Actually, this is for the alternate. The members are full, but there's alternates that are available. Oh. I don't even know if there's a limit on alternates. I don't think there is, but this is the first request for an alternate. So she has not been able to make it this evening.
Don't you need to be a registered voter?
Right. So,
can I ask a question about that? As far as the Conservation Commission goes, how does an alternate work? If a regular member does not show up, the alternate can vote, or do they have
no.
They can't. They so can't they do it's basically a learning curve.
Yeah.
It's a learning. And then, if there was a vacancy, then we could move that person.
Is that the same way with the zoning board also?
The zoning They
have to have so many, okay. All right, so it's different.
Each board has their own category, you know?
So it's basically a, that's great.
It's actually set by the charter and by the state on that. If we wanted to change the conservation, we would have to do a charter change.
No, I think that's a good thing. We'll get some learning curves going. Awesome.
Absolutely.
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye? Okay, that's approved. Thank you. Now, so next on the agenda, this is something that, it's been on once or twice before, and we pushed it off, but now that I finally did my town manager's evaluation, sorry again. I promised I would have it done by today, and we finally did it. So, so I hope everybody's had an opportunity to look through the 2016 goals and objectives, and then, Rick, you were kind enough to put a 2017 proposed goals together here. So let's have a bit of a discussion on that.
Yeah. You know, people did provide me comments in different formats, so I did try to kind of compile it into, and some of it was a little bit of summarizing and paraphrasing people's comments, so I apologize if I may have slighted some of people's comments or thoughts, but I did my best. And I know this has been out here for a couple meetings, so I haven't had any incredibly negative feedback, so I hope I did that reasonably well for most people's standards. So hopefully it's in reasonably good format for people's approval at this point. So, but.
I mean, anyone, if you, I don't know if we want to go through the 2016 goals or whatever, but when I was looking through this, I was just, particularly with the 2016, one of the things, I know we even mentioned a capital improvement plan here. Can we get access to that? Do we have a capital improvement plan as far as?
Yes. We have a five-year capital improvement plan, yes.
Yeah.
Which we update every year.
Okay,
yes.
Great. I'd like to see a copy of it.
Absolutely, yeah.
Would it be appropriate that anything that wasn't fulfilled in 2016 be rolled into the 2017 goals and objectives?
Yes. Yes. I mean, some of these are, ongoing. Obviously, landfill management, capital improvement plan. It's on here. It's really an ongoing goal. Certainly, even if, no offense, but if the Board of Selectmen didn't want to roll it over, we'd keep doing it anyway because it's, a fiscal management practice. So, so some of these would continue, whether or not they were formally on a list or not. So I would agree with that, Bob.
Rick, on the Griffin's Dairy, we still have a Griffin's Dairy committee.
Mm-hmm.
We do?
We do.
Yes.
Do they meet? And what's the purpose of that committee?
I actually don't know what their meeting schedule has been. I'd have to check on that. I know they were, historically, I believe they were advisory to the Board of Selectmen. It was an advisory committee, but I don't know what their meeting schedule has been.
I think their initial charge was to advise on a reuse for the...
Right.
I think
it's kind of like been pushed off, other than the playing fields that we're working on now and the guard. But I'd kind of like to see that brought back and maybe come up with a plan over the next few years, especially with the Community Preservation Act.
Yeah.
We may be able to do some other things here. We may be able to build a pavilion. We may be able to bring some electricity or water out there. The Abington Celebrates Committee did the Oktoberfest last weekend, and we did it in front of the Frolio and American Legion because we had power there and we had water there. I would like to see us now start moving forward again on that. I know when Kenny was on the committee years ago, they'd come up with some plans, and obviously we didn't have any money to do anything. But we may have some money now with the Community Preservation, and I think it's one thing that we should be looking at. Finally, I'd like to see a full recreation area there. Fields, a pavilion, charcoal barbecue things, picnic tables, so people can actually use it.
Right. Mm-hmm. And if you remember, you appointed Mr. Peck, Tom Peck.
Yes, well, that's...
He was the final member of that committee.
Yeah.
And he was inspired because of the field, because of his garden. He did have the best garden, but also all of the fields and all the work going on, and that's exactly what they were talking about.
Yeah, so I think it's time that maybe we bring them in at the next meeting and, or a future meeting and have a discussion with them, what their ideas are, and maybe get the ball rolling again on that.
Yeah, because I mean, they're passionate about Griffin's Dairy.
And you have the outlines of a plan from, that plan from the Old Colony Planning Council.
Old Colony Planning Council, right.
Exactly, so, yeah.
I think that's a good idea, and maybe rework their charge a little bit as to what they should be doing.
That's probably a good idea, yeah.
You'd want to do it in conjunction with them, not just...
Yes, right.
I think they'd appreciate that.
Yeah.
So why don't we do that, and then, you know, over the next year or so, maybe we can do something out there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's actually a great idea. It's amazing what Abington Celebrates has done lately. You know, it's just reinvigorated this whole community, community events.
And there's lots more to come.
And lots more to come. And then you look at the different sites, because you guys were looking around, you know, for different sites of where to do this stuff, and you're right. We've got Griffin's Dairy, which is moving along, hopefully getting into the fields.
At our next meeting, we're going to, Abington Celebrates is going to come in and tell you what our next Christmas event is going to be.
All right. Waiting in suspense.
Yep.
Keep us in suspense.
Always keep them wanting more.
So, yeah, so why don't we try to get those guys and put them on sort of notice that we like them, and maybe Griffin's Dairy has to meet before they come into here, but
that
might be a good idea.
We will advise them of that, too, yes.
Also along the lines of the goals, I know this is something that Mike Franny and I were kind of passionate about, but nothing really sort of, it's the website, again, if we can...
Seems to be the consensus issue.
It was something that we kind of all identified as something that, I mean, certainly that's where existing residents and future residents look to, you know, to find information about their town. Phone calls just are not particularly convenient for anybody anymore, so a website where they can go and get information and possibly pay bills and get forms, we'd really like to see an uptick in that. Information on there, and I know that it takes people to keep track of things and update things when something is new, but I think it's important to do that. It's a mindset change too. When you update something, you just got to remember update the web.
Yeah, I think the last couple of years, and I know some of you probably are aware of this. The MMA has been doing some web innovation awards for around the Commonwealth. So I think we're getting in a better, not to be, I don't know.
We apparently haven't won one of those.
No, we haven't, but I was going to say not to be too, I don't know what the word is, but I guess not to be too overtly ripping people off, but I think we're in a good position to overtly rip people off and see what is it that are being recognized as really some of the better practices, because, obviously from a staffing standpoint, to have somebody just look at websites to just determine what's good, that's not really a practical use of time, but to be I think we're getting to be in a better place to look at, to depend on those types of outlets to see, you know, who's doing a better job. As you know, we use a software package that's well regarded throughout the Commonwealth, but it's a type of package that it has it's one of those, well, what does each community do with it? It's not just a matter of it's not just a one user fits all. It's a matter of how you use that software package that you're paying for. So that being said, I know it's an issue. Again, it's an opportunity. It's not an issue. It's an opportunity. Certainly, to the extent that anybody wishes to provide us with any, continues to provide us with specific areas that they'd like to see us enhance, that's always helpful too. So don't be bashful.
You're right, though. It's best practices. Who's doing what and when they're doing it well.
Right.
I think learn from others too, and what works and what doesn't. What do you guys have as far as? I think we're still on goals. If we look at, and we can continue on the 2016 goals if you want, or we can go right into the 2017.
Would it make sense to just? Go on to the 2017.
I think so too. Yeah, a lot of them are similar. So
yeah.
All right. So the 2017 proposed goals, and are these? Do you consider these in order? of priority?
No, no, just, no, really, some of them are, they're not alphabetical either, it's just a matter of, some of them are a little bit of carryover, so it's really a matter of convenience and on my part, so no, not specifically priority.
Many of these we've actually talked about already today. Continue to facilitate plan for use, reuse of Griffin's Dairy, which we of course just talked about. Complete labor agreements.
Sure. And again, I'm sorry not to interrupt, Maureen, but again, some of them weren't specified by members of the board, but I carried them over because, again, for instance, a business council, that's something that continues to be a work in progress. So, so I, you know, just took it upon myself to carry it over. And again, speaking to Bob's point, too.
Number seven, the signed bylaw. Have the other boards appointed someone for those positions? That position?
They have. They have for the signed bylaw. Yes.
They have. So we're waiting for
a resident and a resident business owner. But we have not had any applications yet.
Well, if you're out there in TV land.
Yeah. I'm not sure we should keep waiting. Honestly, if, yeah, you know, we can always put somebody on after we start.
If we wait much longer, we're not going to be ready for a meeting. Town comes meeting.
Quickly. Right.
I think maybe we should discuss that on the next agenda.
Yeah. And maybe appoint a Board of Selectmen at that time.
Yeah, because that was a big deal at town meeting. We want to make sure that we have something, something that we can truly propose at this next one.
Well, if the Business Association is meeting before then,
you could put it up to them.
That's Thursday.
It's Thursday.
That's actually an excellent point. That's this
maybe
Thursday.
Someone
we'll mention it there.
We will make sure.
Are you both going to be there, or one of you going to be there?
We'll both be there.
Yeah, push to have someone. That's a perfect opportunity to get somebody
I'm
there.
I'm planning on being there myself.
Oh,
perfect.
Good.
Okay.
Excellent. Your goal
actually,
is to
I
not let them
up
leave.
To be a
I'm glad you raised that, because I that would have been a missed opportunity, so thank you. Although we have all their contact information, but still, we're going to be careful how we use it in respect to them, so.
For number nine here, final disposition of West Abington Hall.
Yes.
I agree. I know we were going to try to get something on the on one of our agendas here, but it's not happening, so.
Yeah, and I'm, again, waiting for one of the proponents to get back to me with some of his conversations
Think,
with.
Maybe we should reach out one more time to the.
Be happy to do that one more
opponents
time.
And give them one last chance to come before us if they'd like to.
Happy to do that.
This has been going on since the town meeting.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We would still have to wait until the town meeting to do anything with the building. Is that the case?
Yeah.
Yes. Should we need an appropriation for?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
And here we are entering another winter season,
right.
Which
yes.
will not be favorable to that building.
Would we need an appropriation if something happened to that building over the winter and we needed to take it down?
Well, if there was an emergency situation, then we would obviously seek whatever remedy through finance committee or dispensation from the Department of Revenue if necessary.
And we still have the funds in the demolition article for Griffin's that our intent was to transfer that into
yeah, we
that.
Have money
so
left over.
That article is still sitting
yeah.
there. Yeah.
But that was
right.
just specifically for Griffin's.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So maybe we can just add to that particular goal by annual town meeting so what
yeah,
it's
be,
finished
yeah,
be, this
yeah, yeah. Be too, yes.
year.
Right.
So again, on TV land, if you proponents are watching.
Yeah, no, and again, Mr. Conley and I mentioned I'd spoke to the board about this past at a conversation, and he had wanted to follow up with some community groups and then get back to me. And I know he's hasn't quite done that yet, but I don't know what his issues, pressures are, and I don't want to, you know.
Yeah.
And I like how you have disposition of the North School and Central School upon completion of the New Middle High School, just carrying that forward
yeah, yeah.
until such time as.
But that's going to be pressing as well, because that they're looking to go in there in September of 2017, so the next school year, that's going to be turned over to us.
Moving a lot more quickly than we had.
Right, exactly.
Basically, a year from now, we're going to be looking at.
Yeah, less than a year, yeah.
They'll have to move out, and then that's going to be freed up, I would imagine, by the school committee to us.
Right, and then we're going to be responsible for the maintenance and the heating and all that, so.
It's a good list.
And how about number 14? Consider a new building land committee to make recommendations to the Board of Selectmen on all surplus building and land. Don't we already have such a committee?
That didn't quite work out as we had hoped.
You do have one still.
I believe that committee is.
Constituted. It has not been disbanded yet.
Right, I believe that committee is one meeting away from coming before this board to see how they want to continue.
Okay.
You know, with a list of, we've looked at every single town-owned property, even the minute little pieces, and we have a list of, we basically want the Board of Selectmen's direction as to how you want us to proceed. We don't want to invest more time in saying, yeah, we want to put this on the market, and then have you guys, so, you know, we're going to come to you with a complete list of all the properties in town. And we have one more meeting to do that.
So you think we'd want to see these guys in November or early December?
Probably, yep, probably early December. We meet in November, so. And then it might be a case where the Board of Selectmen might say, okay, the schools will worry about that, and the surplus land committee can worry about it.
Separate study committees, perhaps.
This committee is looking for that kind of, you know, guidance and input from you, from this board. They don't want to do a lot of work that's going to not need it.
I'm sorry, Mark.
I was going to say, and 15, with the dog park development, that has really taken off so kind of quickly once things got started.
It appears that they're going to have the money to get the land surveyed and a plan drawn, and that's the first step before they can apply for the grant.
Nice.
So I'll actually be talking to the surveyor this week to get going on that.
Once that happens, we just wait for the grant to be approved, and then
maybe by the spring.
I would hope by the spring.
Yeah,
it'd be nice. Lots
and
of
again,
things.
This isn't a competitive bid. I mean, a competitive grant. If we meet the criteria,
we get it,
and we'll meet the criteria.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And then, could you speak to number 4, Rick?
Currently, I know one of the issues that had been raised was the applicant pool for police officers under the current civil service system. And in order for the town to hire police officers outside of that system, we would have to have an amendment to our current charter. I don't know that most communities have that type of provision specifically written into their town charter. Sometimes it's adopted through a bylaw or just as an acceptance by town meeting. So it's a little bit abnormal to have it written right into a town charter. So seeking to remove it specifically from the town charter would allow the town to consider whether or not they wish to have it police officers to be hired under the civil service system. Again, it's I think the applicant pool it's obviously something worthy of debate, but I think that I know the applicant pool in the last several years has been questionable as to whether or not it meets the needs of the town of Abington.
Can I ask a question on that? The fire chief spoke about he's had good luck with using civil service. Now, is it okay to not use civil service for the police, but to continue using it for the fire?
No, absolutely, yes.
I just wanted to make sure that.
Yeah, I would want to have that discussion and understand the implications
Yes, I think that would probably be a worthwhile conversation some night, perhaps when a police chief comes in, maybe for a scheduled update, that might be a good time to have.
Or even town council could give us
The ins and outs of the parameters. I think that's absolutely.
Is there anything the board would like to see added to this list?
Just maybe one or two things, just based upon John's comments tonight about the NPD's approval for the, could we just add that on there, just so we know that we're working towards trying to get that NPD's approval? And then what's the organization as far as the Recreation Department itself goes right now? Is we have, Park and Rec has been rolled into, or Park Departments has been rolled into the DPW. So is it, there's somebody separately dealing with the recreation end of things, correct?
Well, the Public Works Administration is in charge of recreation also. And in the future, all recreation recreation board members are subject to appointment, not to election.
Right.
And the administration of Park and Rec is, again, is public, is within the Public Works, so under John Stone from here on in. So that's
so scheduling of fields and all that will be done through
The John Department Stone's of Public Works. Correct, under his.
How about recreation programs? That's going to be more the recreation appointed recreation department.
Well,
I mean, recreation again, commissioners.
Director.
No, that's all. Again, the appointed the recreation commission doesn't have any appointing authorities.
No, no. But how about developing new programs? If somebody wanted to develop some new recreation programs for the town,
right,
how would they go about? Well, who's going to be overseeing that sort of
thing? That would be done in conjunction with the Park and Rec Commission. That's correct. To the extent that you, that staff needs to be afforded to implement those, that would have to be done in conjunction with the Public Works Department. And currently, there is a revolving fund that would allow for the collection of fees to apply towards the hiring of staff. So that's currently there is some clerical staff, but I know there's going to be a consolidation of staff. As some of the staff turns over, there's going to be some consolidation, but some part-time hours may still be available for to dedicate towards recreation during the recreation season.
So there's no designated recreation director?
No.
Is that something that?
Well, from a financial standpoint, right now I can't say that that's something we can commit to unless there's a way we could demonstrate that a fee-based system could pay for that. But again, it's premature for me to say that's the case. I think that really comes down to what types of programs would be outlined by the Park and Recreation Commission as we go forward. So we are in a little bit of a growth pattern right now with the transitioning to a Public Works Department.
Yeah, I don't want to see recreation kind of just fall by the wayside here.
Right.
And not have,
I think it is going to be remaking itself a little bit, though, under the
I understand
different
that,
administration, right? You know, and again, I don't want to, I think it's also a little bit premature for us. And again, it's a little bit of ignorance, perhaps, and see how this develops in terms of how much, like I said, how much of the current administration can be dedicated to park and recreation. I think a little bit of that is wait and see. Is it a situation where there may be some part-time staffing that could be dedicated to that on a year-round basis?
Would you object to a goal around recreation?
I wouldn't object to that. I know in the past there has been. I know that's been something that's been that I know the board has discussed. I don't think it's a new concept at all. Again, it's anything. It's putting the numbers around.
Yeah, I understand that, but it's just so it's on our radar screen.
I don't have a problem. I think
it's
hard to object to recreation, but again, it's just a matter of can we put
right
numbers to programs and.
I just want again. I don't want to
no,
see
fine
it fall by the wayside.
No,
so
that's if one articulates something. You look. You just want to get to an even 20, just to make.
Well, that gets us there.
I'm sorry.
Just to.
Robust.
No, that's fine.
Ensure or look to the development of a recreation program.
So the current elected officials that are in the Park and Rec Department are going to roll off to being appointed officials as their terms expire.
Yes. Yes.
And how many members are there?
Supposed to be five, and we have a full board now.
Thank you. Which actually, I know there was some of the people, I think we were finding that people didn't want to, were concerned about serving because they had to run for reelection and put themselves out there for, you know, because sometimes elections aren't all that, you know, rewarding, and the people that want, just they just want to serve, you know, they just want to serve. They don't want to have to spend that kind of time and energy and money running for election for, so.
I think there might have been some question, too, about how would the Recreation Commission exist under a DPW until things started to sort of shake out a little bit. Who did they, what was their charge? Who did they report to?
Right.
I like adding that. I like that there's 20. To develop a...
Let's just keep it at 20.
Let's go for 30.
I'm only kidding, no.
All right. And it's always good to have these stated goals, and of course things change because last year I'm not sure we even had certain things on the docket, and now they just kind of come about. So, anything else you guys want to add or change?
Just in conjunction with this, I was just thinking to make it easier when we do Rick's review, would it be a good idea to have you on a quarterly basis, maybe just update us on each one of these, just to see where things stand.
No, that's fine, and I think for the most part, I think I try to do that.
You do
reasonably so, and I think given, I don't know if you have an objection to the current format that I tend to use. Is that a spreadsheet type format?
No, this is great. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That'd be happy.
And
to
sometimes
do that.
You cover some of them in your time manager's report and all that. But I thought maybe just on a quarterly basis, if you could just
happy to
give us some brief synopsis on where each one stands. Just good. Thanks.
Thank you. So having. I think we've got that together.
Okay.
I will, as I kind of alluded to earlier, that at this point, all of the selectmen have met with the town manager with regard to his town manager evaluation. Bob, I think you were new, so I don't think you met with them. I think possibly the rest of us have. Anyway, so after. Taking into account all of the feedback and all of the town manager evaluations, what we do is we do come out with a town manager summary statement. And this one is as follows. The contract between the Board of Selectmen and the town manager calls for an annual performance review of the town manager. The review includes such areas as supervision, fiscal management, policy execution, and relations with other agencies, the media, and the community at large. After analyzing the input from the individual members, the Board of Selectmen continues to be pleased with the performance of the town manager as evidenced by the recent decision to renew his contract effective this past July 1st. Areas of particular strength include policy execution, citizen relations, and fiscal management. In particular, the efforts and progress in forwarding the Board of Selectmen and town manager annual goals is noteworthy. His composure and calm demeanor in dealing with situations remains a strength noted by the board members. And while progress has continued with regard to reporting and keeping the board updated on various activities, this particular area that some members would wish to see further progress into the future. I wish to thank my fellow board members for their input and Rick for his performance to date and desire to ensure that he is meeting the expectations of the board. Maureen Jansen, Selectman. I do thank you guys all for putting in the time and energy into this annual review and evaluation. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rick, for everything. And Dory, thank you too.
No, thank you. No.
Okay, so now we're up to the Board of Selectmen's manager, the town manager's report for us.
Sure. A few things. First, our health insurance deliberation continues, and as I mentioned here, it really is at the top of the priority list at the moment. We'll be meeting again this week with our union officials with regard to our deliberations on possible on the status of the Mayflower Health Group and possible options for FY18 and beyond. This is again a cooperative effort. I'd like to thank. As some communities have already decided to leave Mayflower, it may become the issue that if you can leave, that you will in terms of your underwriting characteristics. So I'm not making any predictions, but it's something that's that is obviously very important fiscally and in terms of obviously the working conditions and the benefit structure that our employees work within. So again, continue to keep you updated. It's obviously a very, very important issue to all of us. This actually tomorrow night, the Regional Water District has a follow-up meeting regarding the potential water options for Union Point, their ability to perhaps meet those not obligations but challenges, and that is at 5 o'clock at their office. And I don't know, I will not be able to make tomorrow night's meeting. I don't know if any members of the board or can make it. I know there was an initial meeting, I believe, last month on this matter, but I know obviously Chris Aiello, I assume, will be there from the Union Point. As has already been pointed out, October 27th at 9 a.m. this coming Thursday, there is a meeting of our business council association, call it what we will. Hopefully they'll figure that out on Thursday morning at the Abington Ale House at 9 o'clock. We do have some DOT officials who will be there to provide an update on the Route 18 project. We want to thank Senator Keenan's office for helping to get some of those officials there for the meeting. I do think that it's a good opportunity, and as I mentioned here, to try and get a little more aggressive about recruiting some of the local business owners to take a leadership position in this organization. As you know, this can't ultimately be a public organization. It has to be a private organization, which we would obviously be a partner in. But this is intended to be a private organization ultimately. So, and there's obviously a degree of enthusiasm for that. So hopefully, I know Alex has already mentioned he'll be there, so any members of the board that can attend would be great. And clearly, putting the arm on people for their help with the our bylaw review, signed bylaw review, would be a good opportunity too. So again, that's 9 o'clock, 27th at the Abington Ale House for any members of the public business community that would like to attend. And one of the items that I know Andy had asked for, and I've attached it, but there's more work to be done. Our free cash summary for the past 5 years is attached, but this isn't of a huge help to most people. I've asked the town accountant to put together a budget to estimate a revenue profile as opposed to this. This is really the free cash calculation, which is utilized by the Department of Revenue, but it doesn't break out some of those aspects that are more important to people who are looking at it from a local municipal finance angle. I think one of the keys that I know that local finance officials are more interested in is estimated revenue, how that performed, and turnbacks, how that performed, to ensure that that the revenue estimates on an annual basis are reasonable, so that you're not over or underestimating revenue, so that it's being done. You know, I don't want to use the word honestly taken the wrong way, but so it's being done with in an appropriate manner. So that's going to be happening in the next week or so. So certainly, if you enjoy accountant speak, feel free to ask any questions with regard to that. So, and the budget process is underway. Our initial budget requests are due by the end of this month, and then our internal deliberations are going to begin within the next couple of weeks, and we're off to the races. So, and early voting has already been announced. So, that's all I have.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You guys have any questions?
Maureen?
Yep.
Would it be plausible to go back on the 2017 proposal guide and add Route 139 how it's going to affect the residents of Abington? That's going to be a serious project, and given the fact that they're going to come to speak to this business group is good, but I think as a board, we need to make sure we're
understanding what that impact's going to be as we go forward for the next, I don't know if it's 1 year or 2 year timeframe to get that done, but.
Route 18?
The Route 18 one?
Yeah, the Route 18 widening.
Let's get some updates on that as it progresses. Is that what you're?
Yes, yeah. Just so that we're not losing sight of that and what the impact could potentially be on some of our residents.
Yep, and it's a multi-year impact. Rick, can you add that there too?
There goes 20.
I know.
21.
Well, we'll knock something else off.
21.
Might as well keep going with 30.
It's a lucky, no.
I see 25.
Whose team are you on?
But I think that's important, you're right. I mean, that's something that's going to come.
No, I.
Whether we like it or not.
Some of us are already getting calls on that.
I'm sure, yeah. Well, I think in conjunction with the fact that there's water main work going on, I think a lot of there's a lot of misunderstanding as to what work is whose and what, so I appreciate that.
Thank you, Bob. All right, so public comment, having none.
And I promise you, executive session will be brief.
Okay, so we're going to adjourn and a motion to go into executive session.
Motion to adjourn and to go into executive session to.
Not to adjourn, just motion to.
Motion.
Yeah.
To go into executive session for the purpose of strategies related to collective bargaining with the police union and not to reconvene into open session.
Do I have a second on that?
Second.
All those in favor of individually, one by one?
Aye.
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 Aye. All right, so we're good.